Hello, my soccer universe. Last one for this weekend, the Premier League, who had two Monday games, and that's why they are last in there. And yeah, Eredivisie always finishes so nice on Sunday. I actually started regretting that I didn't put them with the Bundesliga and the Austrian Bundesliga as well. But hey, I think I like it that way, because dedicated Premier League doesn't seem quite right to me as well. Anyway, let's get to the results. I'm wearing Liverpool. Basically, there were two choices. It was Liverpool or Spurs. I think those two made really statement wins. Those two are up the table. But since I have three Liverpool and only one Spurs jersey, I decided, yeah, it has to be Liverpool. And I think Liverpool really made a big statement. We'll get to that. But we will start in Newcastle, where Chelsea playing in their weird away jerseys. And yeah, the commentator said Chelsea is playing in orange. I don't know. I think red, maybe pink, but orange, I have not seen it at combination, but it tells you what a weird color this whole thing is. Chelsea dominated proceedings, was the better team. Took the lead through an own goal by Fernandes. And then I think Werner sprinting through half of the field and then setting up Tammy Abraham, who probably should have had a goal before, more or less seals the deal and makes for a really nice 2-0 win for Chelsea. And Chelsea is a team where I honestly have to say, you always have the feeling they could be right up there in contention, but on the other hand, can they keep it together? Is it not a little bit too soon for them? And especially can Frank Lampard, how much is Frank Lampard factor? But I think defensively they got a lot sounder, especially since they got the goalkeeper Mondi from Rennes, so makes them look a lot better. Brighton wins for the first time at Villa in a wild one. Welbeck scoring the first goal. Villa having chances to get it, because before the half they get it after, but then March in the 56th makes it 2-1 Brighton. There are chances up and down. In late there is a yellow red given to Lamptey. There is a potential penalty for Villa, but it ends with it, as I said, the first win for Brighton at Villa. And then we had the big one. Mourinho against Guardiola. This is always a game that you have to watch. I watched it from minute 15 or 20 on, because I finished the last game first. And I missed the first goal with Ndombele playing a great through ball to Son, who just has to put it into the net, giving Spurs an early lead. And that's exactly what the doctor ordered for a Mourinho side. From now on, they could hunker down. And what was it? Guardiola teams have a lot of possession, but do not have enough penetration, and that really haunted them. I think in the first half they had some chances, and probably they should have gotten the goal through Laporte, but it was disallowed, because in the build-up, Gabriel Jesus, and I think that when you see a certain angle, it really looks like it goes on the arm, but I have the feeling it's here, and I think here is now the cutoff. Where he controls with, if the picture that they showed then to see on VAR, it was so not visible. It looked like he's tucking the arm more away. I thought this was a little bit too little evidence, in my opinion, to say that he had the handball, but okay, a referee took it away. You could see the players when they saw it and saw it on the big screen. Ref, are you crazy for this? You're not giving it? I personally, from what I've seen, I would have let the goal stand, but it is what it is. As I said, City had more for the game, but they didn't seem all that dangerous, and Spurs actually looked comfortable, especially in counter-attack. And then Ndombele comes on, Lo Celso, Ndombele comes off, Lo Celso comes on, and in the same minute, Carl counter ball comes to Harry Kane, who has like through the middle Bergwijn and then to the left Lo Celso, plays it really nicely, and Lo Celso makes it 2-0 in the 65th. That kills off the game. They said that, I think, in around the 70th, yeah, Spurs gave up a 3-0 against West Ham, but to be honest, it never looked that way, because I don't see where the goal threat is coming. Sergio Aguero is missing. Is Messi coming? We'll see, but something in Man City just as look right. Also defensively, they don't look all that sound. Goalie, had better times as well. So yeah, it's a weird game, and it was a Mourinho masterclass. The question is, how much of a statement is this now for Spurs? I said it, I think, before the international break already. If Spurs can get the team humming together with all the talent they have in there, I think they could definitely challenge for the title. I just don't want to believe it yet. I think I have my reservations about that, especially since, you know, injuries can always happen, and, you know, maybe Manchester City will get something going. So we have to see how it goes, but I think at the moment Mourinho looks happy, and I think his team is also looking quite good going forward. I don't want to say it was a great game, it was a typical Guardiola Mourinho game, and Mourinho not twice got the better of Guardiola. Are the two coaches still the best at the top of the class? I am not so sure anymore, but they're still two of the very best coaches out there. And yeah, Spurs moving in first place with that one. I can take that already. And it will be interesting where Spurs will end up. I think Champions League is something that is very, very lucky for them. The other Manchester team just won with a penalty against West Brom. I think we don't need to say much more about that. The penalty even had to be retaken. United is one of those big teams that is still not looking right. They have a lot of talent in there, but also the questions over coaching, I think the biggest one. Fulham against Everton. Everton gets another win after three losses in a row. In a game where if you have a hyphenated name, you were likely to score. Calvert-Lewin scores two, puts his tally to 10, takes the top of the chart, one ahead of Son with 9. But, you know, Son and Kane are probably the best duo in the league. But we are talking Everton. Reed can quickly briefly equalize, but, you know, before they have it's 3-1 Everton. But that game got tied. There was a missed penalty again for Fulham, and then Loftus-Cheek pulls one back, but Everton can hang on. But, you know, this is the second time that a missed penalty by Fulham cost them a point, and, you know, those are the points that you need to get if you want to stay up, and Fulham will not look good staying up. Sheffield United also does not look good, and West Ham gets a 1-0 win, and West Ham, despite having a really tough opening program, has only lost to Liverpool. Big credit to them. I think we will see a much better West Ham side than last season. We have not seen a good Arsenal side. I mean, Leeds Arsenal. I really thought this will be a game where there will be goals. No, Arsenal really disappointing. Leeds hitting, I think, twice if not more the woodwork. A headbutt by Pepe basically makes Arsenal hunker down. They then even had the big chance through Saka, who did not make it to win it. But I think if there would have been a winner, it should have been Leeds. Arsenal looking terrible, absolutely terrible at the moment. They need to make the next step. And I don't know whether signing old players like Willian really helps their cause going forward. For such a big team, I think they have also missed kind of almost a decade of solid building a good team. But they always mess it up. They're not willing to put in the money to really compete up there, although I think Arsenal probably could do so. But yeah. Also, Leeds not scoring many goals as of late. And, you know, with Leeds, we are also seeing they're kind of gravitating towards a midfield finish. And then we get Liverpool against Leicester. Leicester, I think, had one chance that should have been converted, but it was already 1-0 for Liverpool. Liverpool dominated that game. Pushed it around, shoved Leicester left and right. The first goal by Evans was kind of funny because he's so concerned with blocking Mané that the ball falls on his head and into the goal. Diogo Jota, this was a really nice team goal where the ball comes from the right, changes over to the left, Robertson crosses in, Diogo Jota can head it in. This is how Liverpool is switching from left to right, right to left, and even without Alexander-Arnold, this is possible. Milner doing a good job and even assisting the own goal to make it 1-0. Second half, that Firmino took until the 86 was a little bit of a travesty. There was a chance by Mané where he has to play Jota to make it earlier 3-0. Then Firmino, I think, once hits the post or has a chance where the defender then hits the post and he himself hits the post. The ball bounces back to him, goes seemingly into goal, but just a little less than this finger. It is not over the line. So Firmino was really trying to score his goal. He scores with a head, and Liverpool very, very, very convincingly 3-0. As I said, I didn't see anything from him against Burnley, beating Crystal Palace 1-0, getting their first win of the season, I think. And Wolves against Southampton adds 1-1. You know, these are two of those sides where you think they could maybe mount a Europa League challenge, but maybe not quite so. But they are two of the more exciting sides, definitely in England. So the standings, and note the background of the goal average and the disbalance measure, they're all kind of light green, so it's all relatively good still. It is a very even league only at the end. I think after Brighton, it kind of really cuts off. Brighton should be much better in the table given their performances. I think once they once their performances convert into actual points, I think Brighton will move definitely mid table. But we have Spurs on top, first time in a long time, and right behind is Liverpool. So the Champions League finalists are all on top, and Liverpool are now firmly favorites again to win the title. City losing, Liverpool winning, puts them squarely in the top spot there. Chelsea is number three still, mainly down to rating and having a bunch of good players. Spurs moving now in there into the fourth spot. So those are the top four. Could well be that it ends up that way, but we have to see where City going. Leicester City is there on the bounce. We also have to see Leicester. The last time they lost so big to Liverpool was at home. This kind of derailed their season a little bit. So I hope this doesn't happen to them this time around. The middle part of the table is really, really broad. I mean, Manchester City has a game in hand. If they win this, they have 15 points right up there where Aston Villa is, so also not too far off the pace. It's just that I think Spurs and Liverpool are a little bit separating themselves from Chelsea, Leicester. The rest, I think there can be a swap at any time. Even United, if they would get the win, they're at 16 points, right up there with Everton. So, you know, it's not that they're out of it. It's just it's such a broad midfield that you never know. It can change a lot, and that keeps it tight at the moment, and probably will stay tight for a while until we get a little bit later into the season. Just on the bottom, it really seems that the bottom four teams will make the only one will survive, and at the moment Fulham and West Brom are still odds on, and Sheffield United also does not look good. So Burnley with the win got themselves a little bit out of trouble. So we have only two teams that have not won yet, which is West Brom and Sheffield United. Next round, yeah, we will see what Spurs is made of. They have to play at Chelsea. That's an absolutely huge game right there. Liverpool at Brighton, I think, is also a sleeper game. I told you, Brighton is quite kind of playing well. Everton, Leeds United. I don't know. A month ago, I would have said, oh, this will be goals, goals, goals. I don't want to call those things anymore. Also, what else do we have? We have Arsenal against Wolves. Wolves is a team that Arsenal is beating regularly, but I don't know at the moment how this will happen. And then we have West Ham United against Aston Villa to close out the round. Two teams that have a common history because of jersey colors, but also two teams that maybe could go for Europa League spots there. Let's briefly end it in the Netherlands, where I actually saw a little bit of Twente against PSV, where in the first half PSV had many chances. And I think the most remarkable thing is Twente has Maybach jerseys. Maybach, do you remember them? That's when Barcelona was very, very, very good in the early 90s, 80s. So I did not expect Maybach to show up suddenly in the Netherlands. Twente then gets in, but they can really thank the goalie who made a great save just before the first goal of PSV. through Malen. He saved the penalty in the 44th, and then only in the second half, Danilo pulls one back for 20, and probably they could have even gotten a win, but that would have been a little bit too much because PSV really had good chances. Ajax having no problem with Heracles. It was 3-0 at the half. Traoré, Neres, Labiat, and then Tadic, and again Labiat making the rout complete, 5-0. Rout also Sparta against Den Haag. That's kind of an unexpected rout that Ajax is outscored there. And Feyenoord gets a win at Sittard. I also want to point out that Venlo, the guys who won lost 13-0 to Ajax, have not had a tough or big beating since then. And this is, to me, remarkable. Yes, they are not a great team. However, they had this one loss and they kind of pulled it behind and still get some results. I remember when LASK had their biggest loss in his history, which I fortunately didn't see live in stadium because I was already living in America. It was 8-0 at home, and then they kept losing by big margins for 3 or 4 weeks until everything steadied itself again. Here, I really have to say congratulations. AZ getting also their second win of the season, so they're also a little bit on a roll. And if we look at the standings in the Netherlands, Vitesse has dropped points to Groningen. So Vitesse is now behind Ajax. Ajax really all the way clear on top now. Feyenoord and PSV in 3 and 4. Twente is also up there, so doing well. And AZ is also maybe slowly coming in. They have a game against Utrecht in hand with 17 points. Yeah, they probably would go past Herenveen. So it's pretty much Ajax's league to lose, but we have to see where it goes. The Dutch league, it gets rather disbalanced. You can see it really cuts off at number 8, and arguably even before that. I think that the top 4, and I don't know how long Vitesse will stay in there, and as the other teams that are challenging for Europa League, and the rest is somewhere else. So, let me know what you thought about the games last weekend in England and in the Netherlands. I would like to hear your input. Give me a thumbs up if you enjoyed this video. Subscribe to my channel if you want to see more. And I will talk to you soon. Bye. Hey there. I really hope you enjoyed this video. And if you did, here are some videos and playlists that you might enjoy too. Also, please consider subscribing and clicking the little bell icon so that you get updated whenever something happens in my soccer universe. With that, have a wonderful day. Bye.